Thank you very much, Theo, for being here again. I think it's a guy from... Where are you from? Germany? France? Okay, Belgium! Belgium!
He's got that.
I have a long memory. Yeah. I'm a bit troubled by hay fever, so my voice is not what it should be. So I'll try to keep at this level. Yeah? And that should be sufficient for people to understand me, I hope. If not, yeah, if my voice goes down, yell. Yeah? Okay, so when I was invited for this conference, I remember I told you yesterday that actually I said, I'm not doing small talk anymore. And people here said, that's okay, yeah? You can talk about the history of small talk in your place, which I did yesterday. But you can also talk about what you're doing today, yeah? So I'm not responsible. Yeah? I'm doing pretty technical stuff, but with kind of a broader scope. And I want to talk about that. If only to show that I can do other things than discuss about existential aspects of programming. Also, I'm afraid I'll be in teaching mode. I can't help it. Yeah? So, and before I start, I want to go skip one page. That's the abstract. I want to talk about that. I want to talk about this. So, I guess 2 months ago, I was in Lille for Clément Béras, PhD. I was on his PhD committee. And this is a quote from his introduction. Yeah? And I didn't agree with that. And I actually asked him, not in the same words, yeah, whether treating small talk programmers as sissies wasn't a bit patronizing. Yeah? Which actually, that's what he's doing here. And Stefan, who was the advisor, took revenge on me because I was the senior member of the committee, so I was the chairman of the committee, and he made me read in public the conclusion of the committee in French. Not funny. Okay, let's go one slide back. So this is what I put together as a kind of abstract. And this actually is has a really long background. The first virtual machine I built was actually in the late 70s, one of the very first AST interpreters for Pascal. And I went from there. So I've been building language interpreters. I'm colorblind. For me, a virtual machine is actually an interpreter. And the fact that you JITs behind it is an optimization. Anyway, that's another discussion. So I've been doing this since forever. And I ended up having to teach this stuff. So whenever I build something, I build it for educational purposes, but also for research, for doing things, for trying out essentially algorithms. Not in a production setting. Is it? Do I need it? No. So I prefer holding only this. So I try to build machines that are sufficiently sophisticated, but also sufficiently simple so that I can focus on what I would tend to call research issues and not so much logistical or engineering issues. So there are three aspects associated with this. Yeah? There's an aspect of doing something and explaining it to a colleague. Doing this in an educational context and teaching it. Yeah? And third of it is doing something, yeah, and reminding you what you have actually done in order to use it. Yeah? So it's actually stuff that's Well, everybody does that in an, let's say, academic environment. But these kinds of algorithms are special. So I'm talking in a broader context of memory, memory-based algorithms, which are really so low level that you have to pay special attention to what you're doing. A garbage collector is a standard example. When you build a garbage collector, you're managing memory, and you want to spoil as little as possible memory only used during the garbage collection phase. Which means that certainly in our context, you're confronted with essentially recursive algorithms, because most garbage collectors do transitive closure of some kind of routes. And that's a recursive algorithm, a non-tail call recursive algorithm. So it uses a stack, and this stack is an abstraction that's managed by most, if not all, programming languages, even C. And you don't want to lose a lot of memory in those abstractions while you're doing your algorithm. Yeah? And so that you'll see that lots of algorithms have been developed since a very long time ago. Yeah? And all of them use some clever technique. I'm using the word clever to handle that. So instead of having some 32-bit value on your stack representing something, you want to have this particular bit doing exactly the same thing. Yeah? And you're going to wonder, why doesn't everybody use that for everything, those clever things? Well, they're extremely complicated. Yeah? I'm going to show you a couple of examples, and they easily fit, the source code fits on a page, and they're so, what's the English word? Obtruse, yeah? It's impossible to see what happens in there unless you know what's the reasoning behind it. So what I'm going to do is show you two historical algorithms, small ones. Yeah? Historical means old but still meaningful. And then I'm going to show you how I do those two algorithms using an approach that I have distilled over the years. And then I'm going to use that technique to do two interesting things. At least I think they're interesting. Yeah. And the first one is kind of look man, no hands, see what I can do. And the second one is actually meaningful. Yeah. I call the memory critical. It's a gnome, and I had to invent a name for a title for this speech, so I came up with that. Yeah. And probably a lot of people will say that this is a wrong name. I'm sorry. Yeah. No, I'm not. So we did that. Slang. Yeah. Yeah, as kind of a counter argument, Clément said, yeah, well, okay. Yeah. We can give an algorithm a paint job and make it look a bit like small talk and people will be happy. Not an argument. Yeah. I'm going to use C as a specification language here, yeah? Which it's not made for. Yeah? And I could have painted it into slang, but I didn't have the time. So bear with me, yeah, and use your imagination. And you people will have to prove that you're not sissies. Okay? I'm going to use, as an example, Cheney's algorithm, and another one which I'll mention in a minute. And Cheney's algorithm, you can call it the mother of all copy collectors, yeah, actually. So it goes back to 1970. And it's only a couple of pages, and that's how the algorithm is explained in the paper, right? So boxes and arrows, which you see all over the place, and some kind of halfway natural language pseudocode description. Yeah. The algorithm is sufficiently simple to be understood from that. Okay? Now, why did I choose that one? Because it's the one that we expose our first year students to. In that particular book, which I've been making publicity for while here, yeah, at the very end, it treats language implementation and it presents a garbage collector. And the garbage collector is actually Cheney's algorithm. And in the book, which is a marvelous book, right, you again have a very limited amount of graphics to explain it. And the guys use their, they have a kind of virtual register machine language, which they invented and which they provide an interpreter for. And they express the algorithm, and there you see the full algorithm on the right-hand side. Yeah? And it uses very low-level commands, like register assignment and blah, blah. Yeah? Certainly no recursive stuff. Okay? Second example. The Shor-Wade algorithm. And I'm describing it because I'll be using it in the second half of the presentation. And the Shor-Wade algorithm is presented in the original paper, hang on, by those two guys, but actually Peter Deutsch also has to, a year before that he did some stuff that's related to this. And the Shor-Wade algorithm treats pairs, so think Lisp. Yeah? So actually the first one also, I forgot to mention, it's in a Lisp context. It treats pairs. Both of them can easily be generalized to variable arity memory blocks. It's no big issue. But historically, that's how they were presented, because obviously, the very first garbage collectors were used in a Lisp context. And in the book on the Shor-Wade algorithm, you see a lot of graphics and a lot of English to explain what happens. Yeah. And again, the algorithm is sufficiently simple to be understood from this. So my point at this point, is that when people try to explain garbage collectors, they use all kinds of things like drawings and boxes and arrows and pseudocode and English and what have you to explain how things happen. Now, it goes without saying that over the years, garbage collectors became much more sophisticated. Yeah? So how do people explain garbage collection algorithms today? And I picked one example. Oh, I forgot. Yeah, excuse me. This is the textbook that our department used in the 80s for algorithms. A pretty well-known book. Yeah? And they used the Shor-Wade algorithm as an example in the book. And they describe it in pages upon pages of Pascal code. Executable Pascal code. No sissy stuff. Yeah? It runs. So no pseudocode. Real operational code used as a specification. So, I went looking for modern publications on garbage collection. Now, fortunately, earlier this year, there was ECOOP in Barcelona, before all the troubles. Yeah? And ECOOP had a co-located event, ISMM. And you don't have to be Einstein to guess that MM stands for memory management. And there were, I don't know, less than a dozen papers accepted at that co-located event. And I picked this one because I found it interesting, but also because it proposes something which tends to support my point. So on the left-hand side, the colorful thing, yeah, is a kind of specification, formal language, to handle on synchronization, locks, because this is an algorithm that has to do something with garbage collection in a synchronized context. So they do this kind of stuff for the locking part, but when you look at the garbage collector itself, that's only part of it. They use C. They write down, they write down C. So these things stick around. People consider certain things sufficiently important to provide some kind of formal mechanism to describe it, but not the garbage collection part. So last year, I'm teaching a course in the master level, which is called Programming Language Engineering. And together with students, we build things. And every year it's different. Yeah? But there are some constants, like you always need a garbage collector. So last year, I tried something new, which is what I'm talking about now. So I'm going to try and explain to you Cheney's algorithm quickly using my approach. Okay? As a kind of set of mechanisms that I developed as conveniences. I didn't set out to build something which is a kind of universal mechanism to do this. I just did this, and I found them sufficiently convenient to more or less standardize them and use them in other contexts. So, Cheney uses two half spaces, and when you do a garbage collect, you copy from the old half space to the new one. I found it convenient to have the root reference in the very first cell. Okay? And then I do this. This is the start of a state machine, the initial state of a state machine. You'll find that most of those algorithms can be written, are written as state machines. Yeah? And you can't avoid it. You have to write them as state machines. You end up writing them as state machines. Thinking in terms of C, when you see a C program, that has an infinite loop and a switch statement, and somewhere a break, that's typically a state machine implementation. So that's what we do. So on top, a symbol to say this is the start, and at the bottom, an action associated with this. So the parentheses mean that this is a co-assign. Yeah? So if I use something on the left-hand side that I change on the right-hand side, I still use the original value. That's what I mean by co-assign. And then, now I'm going to have five steps to describe the algorithm. So, bit of word of explanation, I represent cells that way, graphic. The graphical representation is a fundamental part of the process. Yeah? And I hope you can imagine that. A cell is a memory cell, right? So you think in terms, I'm going to use 32 bits throughout my reasoning. So it's a 32-bit value, but in my case it's going to be more. Yeah. So what else do I need to show? A pointer into memory, very standard notation. Yeah. I use two chasing pointers in two static variables. A scan pointer, which initially is set to the first slot, and a free pointer, which is set to the next slot. The free pointer is also used during memory allocation, because you allocate from left to right. Yeah, that's very standard as well. I'm going to be cutting some corners, because I imagine most people are already aware of this. Yeah. So I have these two chasing pointers, and this is my co-assign. And I go to step number two. And every time on top I have predicates which provide a condition under which this step can proceed. And at the bottom, I always have actions. Yeah? And this simply says that whenever I encounter an atom, think small int, whenever I encounter an atom, I'm skipping. Pointers are numbers, and I have to add that cells are not only pointers in my case, but pointers tuples of pointers and types. And a type can be an atom, a pointer, or something which in the algorithm is called a broken heart. For the reasoning purpose, I'm doing it that way. It's a tuple. When you build it in a real machine, you're going to use some clever tricks to combine these flags with the actual pointer. Think 32-bit cells, which means if you have proper alignments, that the last two bits of your addresses will never be used, and you can reuse them to store those things. That's how small ints work, right? So I have a bit of a formal notation. The asterisk is the one you use in C, actually. And the up and the down arrow extracts the types and the pointer value from a tuple, blah, blah, blah. Everybody understands this. Yeah. An atom, yeah. Predicates to determine when to do what. Next step, this is the most complicated one. Let me tell you in English what it says. It says that whenever you encounter, whenever the scan pointer points to a pointer to an unvisited pair, I'm storing my pairs in adjacent cells. Yeah? So in Lisp terminology, it contains a car and a cutter field. So what I do, I copy them to the free pointer, I increment the free pointer, I replace the car in the old memory by a broken heart to indicate that I visited it, and I make the cutter value pointer to the new value, a forwarding pointer, yeah, which I will be exploiting here. If the scan pointer points to a broken heart pointer, yeah, I know I've been there before, so in a new memory I'm going to replace it by a pointer, by the forwarding pointer. That's how you do it. It's a very simple algorithm. Yeah. Step five, yeah, the last step, when free catches up with the scan, or scan catches up with the free pointer, excuse me, you stop. Now, what's so clever about this algorithm? Everybody will say, well, I'm spoiling half of the memory, yeah, which I'm not going to be using for real things. Yeah. But actually, the space in between the scan pointer and the free pointer is your recursion stack. That's where it's stored. That's what's so smart about this. Yeah? And this is the same kind of trick that is being used by all or most copy collectors today. I can put it up in a decision graph. Every loop is a transition. And what I do here is decompose the predicates, yeah, factor out things within the predicates. This gives a pretty clear view of how this thing works. I know you see this for the first time, so it's probably pretty hard to appreciate, but this is really useful. And now the magic, right? This is C code. On the right-hand side, the slash is comments. In the comment, you will see both the predicates and the actions. Yeah? And on the left-hand side, you'll see the corresponding C code. You could actually generate a C code from that without any issue. I did it manually because it's small enough. Yeah? You'll see at the top, you'll see declarations. You'll see the third line describes a cell as a struct. Yeah, and I can compile this. I can compile it, and I can actually, if I want to, run it. Executable specification. And when you go and look to a real implementation in a real garbage collector that I did, you will recognize this stuff in there. Okay. Second example. The Shor-Wait algorithm. Now, this one is only the traversal part, which is the complex part, so the transitive closure from a root. That's the recursive part, so that's where you need to be clever. Following this, will be a collecting phase where you go sequentially through the memory and where you identify the painted pairs, yeah, and you will construct a free list out of the non-painted pairs, which makes this algorithm in this shape pretty much unusable, because you have to do a sequential search of your memory, which you don't want to do. So again, I want to show you the clever part. So initially, I have two chasing pointers called previous and current, PC. Yeah? And again, I put the root in the first slot. And now my cells contain three things, a pointer, a type, and a mark bit. Yeah? The mark bit will be used to paint visited pairs, excuse me. And again, similar operations here, but let's go through it and see what happens. So the current pointer, the previous pointer, and situation number one, the current pointer points to something which I haven't visited before and which contains an atom. Again, what I do, you see the turned down corner of the cell, that's my graphical representation for marking. So I mark, yeah. Step two, an unvisited pointer. I do a cyclical permutation between the previous, the current, and what the current points to. So I make the current descend, and I make the previous point backwards. It refers to the way back. Yeah? It's a very famous algorithm, but this is what it does. What if I point to something which I have visited before? In the case I point to the car, I move to the cutter. Yeah? What happens if I point to the cutter of a visited pair? I have to climb back up. Yeah? So I do an inverse cyclical permutation between pointers, and B comes back up, C comes up. Yeah? So we backtrack. This is a way of backtracking using the memory itself. Yeah? Using back pointers, a very popular and old technique. That's the clever part. And this is the end. So when the current comes back to pointing to the roots, I know I have finished. Yeah. And again, this is the decision graph, where I again factored out all the predicates, and where the edges are marked with conditions or actions. Yeah. So this synthesizes what I've shown you before. And again, the magic is the code. So this is the code for the Deutschel weight algorithm in C, executable at about a quarter of the size that Aho and Ullmann did in Pascal. And I probably don't need to tell you that this is pretty efficient. If you run it, it's fast. Did I lose anyone? You're still okay? Surviving? Yeah, okay. But it's not all that essential to grasp the details. Yeah, I'll leave behind the stuff, and if you really want to have a closer look at it, be my guests. I should tell you that back home, when they see me coming with this stuff on my mind, they cross the street to avoid me. Only a minority of our students appreciates this. And that's one of the big issues, because this is important. Yeah? So I told you I was in teaching mode. Yeah? This is what I do with the students as well. This is something that goes a long way back. I built virtual machines. I roll my own garbage collector. Yeah? And I've been using this one, a compacting mark and sweep, since forever. And this is part of a tutorial that explains the critical part here. First of all, I'm using a generalized shore weight, the one I've been describing before, to do the traversal without having to make an explicit runtime stack, because it's recursive. Yeah? But you need a second thing. So an example, the dark stuff are chunks, which are marked, or which should be marked, from a root. Each chunk has a header cell symbol containing the size, and then you have additional pointers inside each chunk. So the green arrows, I put them in to show you the structure. Now, what a compacting mark and sweep does with it, I'm actually using a variation on this algorithm, which goes back to 79, but I did my own stuff in here, is that you do, again, pointer reversal. And what you're going to do is replace every header cell which contains the size by the beginning of a linked list of all the slots, all the cells that in the original version point to it. So I get these colored linked lists there, and they recoup essentially an inventory, well, they make an inventory of who points to this particular chunk. And then I can move to that one. I can simulate the move, the compaction. I want to compact, and by moving everything to the left-hand side to free up all the fragments in between. And I first do that. I simulate it, and I replace all. I revert the linked lists again, and I replace the original references by the future references. And then I can move. Yeah. This is the expensive one, because here I have to go through the entire memory. Same problem as with the previous one. But I can do a clever trick here so that this one doesn't have to inspect every chunk. Okay? I'll spare you the details. But this is a complex thing, right? Yeah? I combine this shore weight thing, generalized to variable arity blocks, with this threading stuff that I just showed you. And you can do it. And you know how much space you need to do it? One extra bit per cell. And in order to do that, you have to do a bit of magic. Yeah? And that's the end result. It fits on one page. And it's a pretty sophisticated and complex algorithm. Yeah? And I've been using this since forever, and I've always been happy with its performance. And there are lots and lots of non-academic developments which use this approach, but then elaborate it, because, for instance, in Smalltalk, you have a much more sophisticated header to a chunk, and so on. But that's not my focus, as I explained in the beginning. So, again, this compiles and you can run it. Yeah, if you really want to experience what happens, want to observe, and so on. And in this particular case, I have a version running in my virtual machine, which looks pretty much like this, except that the flags are in the last two bits of a 32-bit word address. Okay? Always the same tricks. Now I'm going to show you two non-educational things, but two experiments. This is a Lukmanohans experiment. So what I'm going to do is take my compacting mark and sweep algorithm here, and I'm going to take the shore weight algorithm over there, and I'm going to combine them. I'm going to merge them into one. So a bit macho, but yeah. Why do I want to do that? The obvious reason is that the language my virtual machine accepts is a variation on Scheme, right? And in the original version, I have pairs with the header. So it takes 3 cells to represent a pair of 2 cells. So I want to save storage on pairs. So I'm allocating arrays from left to right, and I'm allocating pairs from right to left. Yeah? And I garbage collect when they hit in the middle, in very, very brief terms. But the original idea behind this is to experiment with far references. Far references are references from one virtual machine to the memory in another virtual machine. Right? Because I have very, very, very bad experience with concurrency issues in garbage collectors. It's not worth it. So I prefer to think in terms of having different disjoint virtual machines that communicate with one another. We have a history of actor languages, yeah, and that's probably part of the thing. And referring to an object in another virtual machine is greatly facilitated if it doesn't keep moving around. Yeah? That's in two words why I did this. So, again.
So, when you say different virtual machines, all referring to the same memory?
No, each is a separate virtual machine with its own heap. Yeah?
Okay.
And if you want to have communication between them, you have to refer sometimes to the other. Yeah? So that one has 7 transitions. That one has 6 transitions. The complexity is given by the number of transitions. You have to count the loops in the decision graph. And I managed to combine them in 15 transitions. Yeah. And the codes, and that's what I have running right now in my machine, is this. And again, I did it completely manually without tools, yeah, with a graphical editor and what have you, and it helped me enormously. And I exposed the students last year to this stuff, and they survived. Yeah. Well, some of them were actually pretty happy. Okay? So it's 50 lines. I'm using C as a specification language. Yeah? Can you imagine?
Yeah.
No. No. Well, look, open your eyes. But you can see that you can easily express this in other media. Yeah? I could have done this in slang. This is not too high level for slang. Yeah, I could have done it. I didn't. Now, second application, which is much more interesting, is this one. And that's a problem that's been bugging me for a very, very long time. And not only me. This, I mentioned before, this step in the compacting, mark, and sweep is the expensive one. That's the one where I go through the entire memory, yeah, and I identify the stuff that's been marked, been painted. Now, and this didn't used to be a problem. But today, I'm using 4 gigabytes of memory for, yeah, even in 32 bits. But 64 bits, you blow up your memory. So this is the expensive part. And that's why when you go and look at, not this book, I took the wrong one, but the first edition of this book, by Richard Jones, which is the Bible on garbage collection. When you look at this, at the first one, he discards the compacting, mark, and sweep as a not interesting garbage collector simply because. Yeah. This third phase. So, and what he explicitly says, yeah, people, yeah, this is the problem, people actually take the mark bits out of the cell and put it in a bitmap. So, for instance, 32 bits, mark bits to a cell. You compress by a factor of 32. Which means, in our kind of condition where this bitmap will be sparse, yeah, only very few bits will be marked, that's what you have in dynamic languages. That's why generational scavenging is working. Because you have a lot of garbage. having a lot of garbage means a lot of bits set to zero in the bitmap. So you can look at 32 bits and decide this is zero, not worth the trouble. So you have an optimization there. This takes extra memory. About 3% of your heap will be used for this. Okay? But still, people are not really happy with that. In dynamical languages, this bitmap is very sparse. Very, very sparse. Huh? So, I'm treating you to an example.
Yeah. The bitmap is very sparse because you have a generation algorithm.
No, because you simply have a lot of garbage.
But you also have a lot of stuff that is not garbage.
You don't have all that much. So, generational scavenging works because you have a lot of garbage. And you reuse.
And also identify stuff that is most likely not garbage and move it somewhere else. I mean.
But a generational scavenger, moves the non-garbage to the beginning, and it uses the statistical given that if you survive a garbage collect, you will probably be there forever. Yeah, that's the statistic. And you can combine this stuff that I'm talking about with generational scavenging. So generational scavenging is orthogonal to the technique of transitive closure. Yeah. Either I copy to another half space or something, or I move to the beginning. Both work. But that's not the issue. The issue is that you have a lot of garbage. Yeah? This example, those of you who know Scheme will see that this is not quite Scheme. That's my dialect of Scheme, and it's it balances a tree, an X tree, which is a tree that contains as the value in a node, a binary tree. The value in a node is the number of leaves in the left subtree. Now, you don't want to know why. It's first of all, it has a lot of nested scope, so I have a lot of interpreter garbage. In a typical approach with these kinds of languages and machines is that you incorporate non-application related data also in the same heap so that you can unify garbage collection for everything. So I have a lot of garbage generated by the interpreter, but since I've written this in a functional style, I challenge you to find a set bang in here. Yeah? You'll see a functional style, I have a lot of application garbage. Yeah? Okay? So, this is preliminary. I put it up explicitly, and it's preliminary because I did this last month. The algorithm I'm showing you, I finished it last month, so it's really still hot from the oven. Yeah? So, the interesting part is the yellow boxed part. Yeah? It says that the first stage takes this many seconds. The expensive part, the right bottom part, see, half a second. And the third phase takes some time because I also have, this one is also using the previous version with the, both the arrays and the pairs. Okay, so I did what is said in the book. Yeah. Before I, a 32-bit memory, and I'm using a heap of 900 mega words. Why not a giga word? Because I also need space for the code and other data structures. So it's a big memory for a 32-bit machine. And that's the result. If I do a bitmap, it improves by an order of magnitude. Well, you would expect times 32? No. Yeah. But this, as I said, preliminary. Yeah. And now I'm going to use something which I call a bit heap. See? And the yellow box stuff says, if you compare this with the previous value, and you see that phase 2 and 3 become negligible with respect to the traversal part, and the traversal part is slightly more expensive than in previous cases, because the marking phase will be more complex. Yeah. So the clever part about this is the one called bit heap. Yeah. I have 10 minutes. Okay, I'm almost done. I call it a bit heap by analogy with bitmap. Yeah. Well, problem is the name is taken. Oops. The name is taken. Yeah. A bit heap apparently is something that's used by microcode engineers, yeah, to stream data inside the CPU when they do, for instance, multiplication. Yeah. Something like that. Other than that, I cannot see anyone doing this kind of stuff. So this is probably new. So it's a heap, so it implements a priority queue. If I remember correctly, the collection hierarchy has a heap implementation somewhere. Does anyone know that? Yeah? Yeah? The collection hierarchy in Smalltalk has a heap implementation somewhere as an implementation for a priority queue. In my case, the leaves of a heap is a tree. Yeah? The leaves of the tree are my memory words. Can you imagine? 32-bit words all over the place. But they're not explicitly present in the heap because they're already in memory. And on top of the basic memory, I built a tree, yeah, of arity 32. So I bunch together every 32 successive words into one node of my heap. It's a perfectly balanced tree. Yeah. So I can represent it as a static structure. I don't need to have pointers in the tree. So the drawing is not too clear about this, but you each time consecutively store the successive children of a particular node.
It's not only balanced, but full.
Balanced and full, yeah, complete. Yeah. And I'll talk about the magic numbers in a minute. Yeah? Each node contains 32 bits. Yeah? And every bit refers to a lower lying node of 32 bits or to an actual word in memory. Yeah? And each bit, yeah, says whether the subtree has a bit set to 1 somewhere. Right? So if my information is sparse, if the bits are really sparse, this means that a lot of the nodes will be zero. And the more you descend through the tree, the more the nodes will be zero. That's what this statistics will tell me. And on the top, yeah, the size of my bit heap will be 34 million and some. Is that correct?
Yeah. Yeah? It's still 3%, isn't
it? It's slightly more than 3%.
So it's, yeah, it's just 1 bit per slot.
Oh yeah, so yeah. But I mean, with the bitmap was 3%, right. And this will be slightly more, but the superstructure of the tree is really, it decreases very rapidly. So it's not that much more expensive than a bitmap. Huh? And the size, you can compute it like that. Yeah. This is the way I implemented the set. So I did loop and rolling here. Yeah.
So this is the bit heap is not for optimizing space, but for optimizing the algorithm.
For optimizing, deciding whether, so, or deciding where the marked chunks are.
Because yeah? When we say sparse, the first thing that comes to my mind is saving space.
This is different. Yeah. So marking a bit in the heap, I do it like that. So for instance, a left shift by 5 is multiplying by 32. Yeah? So I really went crazy over this. And this is pretty efficient, okay? You can improve on it, but I didn't. And what you see down here, I call it a do. I have to add an underscore because do is a reserved word in C. But this is a Smalltalk do. I send a do to the bit heap with a block, yeah? Which I call a lambda because I'm a lambda guy. Yeah? And this one, I did loop and rolling, and each time I enumerate all the bits, and as I descend, each time I test whether a node I encounter is completely zero. And if it's completely zero, I backtrack. Yeah? There are better ways of doing it than this. Yeah? Not with, you don't want to know. But this is the most readable, or the least unreadable. Yeah? Yeah? So, I call do with as a lambda phase number 3 of my garbage collect. And it's going to apply the lambda successively to each word in the memory that has been detected as being marked. And the performance that I showed you before, this one, is essentially because of that. Right?
Excuse me.
Yeah.
So you're working all the bits together as in the bitmap implementation.
Yeah.
And you're replacing a random access bit check with a heap traversal.
Yeah.
So it's only faster because cache in the microprocessor.
No. 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 Because this is an app. No, no. Hang on.
And so then you skip one chunk. Yeah. Yes.
Hang on. Because I'm victim of my own ambition here. Yeah. This is an applicative operation. It's really a do. Yeah. So you don't have to go through the tree for everything you go. It's a traversal of a tree. Yeah. Where I backtrack whenever I decide. It's a kind of branch and bound, if you want.
Traversal of the logic tree.
So this is clever. Even if I say so myself. Yeah? So I think it's sufficiently clever. It's sufficiently clever to be published. So, but it's as I said a month old, so I need to do stuff with this and I'll see what happens. Yeah? And I thought this was really ideal to really extract the non-CC-ness from this public. Okay? So this is the kind of stuff I do today. I also build interpreters, I program in scheme, I do, but this is also what I've been doing recently, in case you wanted to know. So, 32 bits, why not 64 bits? When I do it correctly, I can use exactly the same algorithm in a 64-bit architecture for heaps up to 32 gigabytes, which is okay. If you want to do more, you have to rethink not the principles, but the algorithm. So it's promising. It's scalable to, in the best case, 32 gigabytes in its current shape. How does it handle complexity? It doesn't handle concurrency, real-time, it doesn't handle non-uniform memory architectures, yeah? But I suggest this approach could be orthogonal to some of those, yeah? I need to do some formal support because now the formalism is limited to the predicate action combination, which is a pretty simple approach to state machines, yeah? So, but there's a lot of literature on state machines, so a lot of the things that I can find in the literature will help me in proving that complex algorithms like this are complete and non-redundant and blah, blah, blah. But these are sufficiently small to do it manually. Tool support, I hate using graphical editors. Yeah? So the graphs I showed you, I did them by hand. I don't want to continue doing that. So tool support, if this ever becomes meaningful, we need tool support. And my title is not specifically about garbage collection, right? Yesterday I already referred to become. Yeah? The become implementation for Squeak has a lot in common with a traversal used for a garbage collector. Right? Yeah. You have all the interest in the world in having this be efficient. I'm using a become in small in scheme because with a redeval print based language, your global environment frame keeps on growing and growing and growing, and you need to reallocate it frequently. Yeah? And reallocation means replacing all the references in the system, in the heap, to the global frame by another one. I'm doing that with the kind of become algorithm. Yeah. So, just a question. Who heard before of the short wait algorithm? Very limited number of people. It's extremely interesting if you want to, yeah, if you want to write something even in Smalltalk, and you have to do a traversal of a complex network, and you want to avoid having a worst case behavior where your recursion stack becomes the same size as the memory you're using. Don't say it doesn't happen. Yeah? So this stuff is useful, and I want to conclude with this statement. In my experience, procedures, methods to do something are the result of synthesized conventions. If something is convenient, it gets to be combined in something which is a procedure. Yeah? I'm not saying this is at the level of the calculus, but I'm pretty certain that when Newton and Leibniz were arguing about notation for the calculus, they were not arguing about science, but about notation, convenience. Yeah? Yeah?
Both in the bitmap and in the bit heap, you maintain the bits of data when you allocate, right? Like when you allocate the space, you go to the bitmap or the bit heap.
No.
And mark it as used.
No, the mark is only executed when you the first phase of the garbage collect. You do a traversal from the heap, from the root, excuse me, and you paint everything that you encounter. That's how typically it works. Yeah.
You said that this won't scale beyond 32 gigabytes, or might not scale beyond 32 gigabytes. Why is that?
Because of the magic number, because my bit heap, yeah, is the height is 6. And the reason is that 6 times 5 is 30. So I can fit a 30, I can treat 30 bits addresses. Yeah? 30 bit address is 1 giga, is the number of words in a 4 gigabyte memory, right? Yeah? If I want to go beyond that, I can do some tricks and use the last 2 bits which are unused, and I can extend it to 16 gigabytes, and in a 64-bit architecture to a 32-bit architecture.
But shouldn't you use 64-bit words and instead of being 3%, it should be 1.5%?
Well, that's what I meant by rethinking the algorithm.
Okay.
The principles are there, they're okay, but you have to redimension. You want node sizes for the bit heap which are multiples of 8. One way or the other. Probably 16, 32, 64. That's what you want. Yeah? You don't want a size 7 because you're going to lose information. So this requires clever thinking and being able to do basic arithmetic. Okay? You guys look clobbered. Yeah, you may be surprised.
When you showed the example of the times it took
you said that you had, if I understood correctly, you had a heap of 900 megabytes.
No, I'm allocating a heap of 900 megabytes because I only have 900 megawords, because I only have 1 gigaword available to me in a 32-bit architecture. And it has to fit not only the heap, but other stuff as well. So the just arbitrary 900 million, excuse me.
But the question was, how much of that space was actually used? Because you said there were like 900 gigawatts of gigabytes.
Yeah.
And then you said after, I understood that after GC you only have 0.01.
Yeah.
But
this is an excessive example, I told you. Yeah. So it fills up the memory 66 plus 25% filled, see? Yeah. And then it reduces that to very little. So you have to scale this. That was my argument about scalability. So if you're going to have far less garbage than this, the numbers will go up. Yeah. But all the numbers will go up because traversal will also go up. Yeah.
But
so the only thing I did... Yeah, this is not going to be interesting if you don't have a lot of garbage. That's clear. Yeah.
Because my question is, what's, for example, in a generation like Collector, I'm not sure how much memory you're having as garbage. But I'm pretty sure that it's not a relation that you are going to need only 0.01.
This is an excessive example.
Okay.
I wanted to give myself confidence, so that's what I did. But if you have, you can combine this algorithm. I haven't done it until now because I didn't have the need to do it. But you can combine the compacting mark and sweep with a generational approach, in the sense that if every garbage collects, you remember the free pointer, yeah? And everything before the free pointer, at the beginning of a phase, you consider as eternal, yeah? And when you do your garbage collect, you only consider this part, yeah? You have a bit of complexity because you have back pointers to before the free pointer, yeah? But you can do this, yeah? So I didn't do it. But with every generational system, eventually you will need to do a bang, yeah, global garbage collects. This is a month old, yeah? It's still wearing diapers. So I need to do some really quantitative analysis of this before I do something. But I was explicitly asked, come and tell us what you're doing right now. That's what I'm doing. Which is not small talk.
Okay?
Okay,
thank you.